We'll be starting with the next session on needs analysis, understanding student perception of online education by Dr. Sudhir Pandey, program chair of MBA at Ahmedabad University. The purpose of this 1 week long faculty development program is to deliberate on what hybrid modalities are, how they can be employed in teaching, and what strategies need to be developed and how they can be implemented for academic success. To help us navigate this yet uncharted future, we have with us Dr. Sudhir Pandey. Dr. Sudhir Pandey holds a PhD in cultural studies from the University of Lucknow. He is the program chair for MBA at the Ahmedabad University. His research interests include how innovative office spaces foster collaboration. He has collaborated for virtual business professional project with the Marshall Business School, University of South California, as an instructor in 2016, 17, and 19. Currently, he is a member of the International Institute for Qualitative Methodology, an interdisciplinary institute based at the University of Alberta, Canada. Additionally, he has served in the membership committees of Association of Business Communication and Urban Affairs Association. We welcome Dr. Sudhir Pandey to deliver his session on needs analysis, understanding student perception for online education.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for this nice opportunity to talk to everybody. So shall I begin? We all are on the, So do we need some break or a minute or two, or should I go on with my session?
I think so, we are good to go.
Okay, thank you so much. So I'll start sharing my screen. It is good to talk to everyone, and this is one talk. Hello. I'm really sorry, I think I lost in the middle. I'm really sorry for this.
That's okay, sir. We request you to continue.
Yeah, so I would like to begin with the context of education, because the need-based analysis is all about the way we learn and the way we plan to offer our courses, the way we contextualize the entire education system. And that's why in the earlier mail, I kept it very simple by saying that, let us first understand how do we learn, what do we do, in what context we are doing this teaching and learning, and what is it that we need to change in our entire approach. So can I get the sharing right so that I can share my screen?
So you have been given the sharing rights.
Okay. I think it is not, because the moment I share, it is saying that the host has disabled the sharing. Yeah, now I am. Thank you so much. So without delay, most of you have heard this and seen this in your lifetime for several times, but I love to talk about, and I love to talk about this quote, and I love to talk about this person. Because I think he has given us a different way of thinking and talking and theorizing about education. And first thing that we all must remember is that, I love this quote, education is not preparation for life, education is life itself. Now, the moment we put this framework in our mind, it clears out a lot of doubts. Because most of the time we see education and educational institute as away from society, or as an institution which is separate from society. So we have a boundary, we have a building, we sit in the class, we have a different kind of method of teaching. There is a set hour by hour teaching schedule and everything. And that gives, I have also suffered from this, that gives a teacher like us the kind of feeling that it is something away from society, and it is something which is preparing for life. But actually that is life itself. If we treat it like that, I think the entire approach will change. And another thing which I really like about this person is another quote from him, that we do not, because I have seen recently people are talking about experiential learning and how experience builds up, and because of experience we learn a lot. It is not important to gain experience, but it is very important to reflect on the experience. So I would like to begin with these two quotes: that we do not learn from experience, we learn from reflecting on the experience. What I'll do, we'll take this session like this. I'll give you the context, and then we'll see what is important in that context that we need to do now. So a lot of researches are happening. You all are familiar. You all are teaching. You have taught at various places in various capacity. And everybody is keeping tune with what is happening. My job is just to talk about the context in which we are doing and whether we are actually appreciating the context in which this is happening, or we are just leaving out the context and focusing more on the process. What I see today, the similarity, is that if you look at this entire industrial revolution that began somewhere close to 1850, and then we saw the emergence of different kind of teaching methods and school, exactly this is what is happening today. So in late 19th century, if you look at the way, I mean, I have put it on slide, the way everything started changing and the way corporations started taking a shape of its own, and the machine went into the production, and that changed the entire structure of the society at that time. And if you look at all the business schools and all these the different kind of education that we are into, that all began as a kind of response to that kind of change in the society. And that structure gave a different kind of flavor to the entire education ecosystem. So I want you to reflect that because the demand in the corporate was something different, the demand in the job market was something different, the demand in the society was also something different. Exactly that started reflecting in the education process. And people saw it as an opportunity to get a kind of skill set, get a kind of knowledge that will give them a job and stability, and that will also improve their life. And that started changing the way we talk about and think about educational institutions and the education per se. And today, exactly, we are experiencing the same way. And this is what I want to emphasize, that we need to appreciate this context. Like from hand labor, we moved to machine labor, and that led to industrial revolution. And because that kind of environment needed a different kind of skill set and people who would work in that environment, a different kind of education system emerged. And that affected the society, individual, everybody, because now I knew that I don't need to work with my hand, but I can get into a good college and good university, get a good skill set, and the kind of requirement which is there in the industry with the same sort of skill set, I can get a job and better my life. And that started changing the entire educational landscape. And that is where the management education and vocational education, skill type education came up. And that started reflecting in the way we see the educational institute. Like if you look at early management schools of 1890, Chicago Booth, and then you look at other schools like Wharton and all, they started this entire training of management, which later on became MBA and all these kinds of things. That was exactly the change that was happening at that time. I see a lot of similarity today. And the similarity is that today we are changing. What is changing in us is that in the job market, workplace dynamics is changing. And there's a lot of talk that automation is happening. In fact, there is a recent book that I came across where it was saying that forget that automation will do this and that. Automation will start doing such kind of work that we do, like creating music, like writing a draft. The automation will affect in such a way that we'll be actually jobless. And jobless in the sense that the machine will take, or the AI will take the kind of job that we can only do. So it is not about only helping us, but replacing us with doing the kind of job that is only meant for us, like creating a draft, creating a musical note, or creating something which is inherently very imaginative for people like us. And this is exactly happening now. And mass production from mass machine has come to the technology. And when we talk about need-based analysis, we need to appreciate this context. If you look at, these are 2-3 points that I put up for people just to have a look. And if you look at, I always remember and quote this one: give a man a fish, he will eat for a day. Teach a man to fish, he will eat for a lifetime. We all know that. Clear. But again, the point in the last one is that he will eat for a lifetime. How do you teach? Is something where I have mentioned, but that's assuming that the way that you teach him how to fish stays relevant for the rest of the life. This is the addition that I want to make. Because whatever things that we do in our lifetime, if we can make that relevant to a student when we do something in the classroom, I think that is the kind of approach that is needed in today's time. And we all are trying to do that. But the most important thing is that what do we do at our level in the syllabus, in our project? What is it that we do that keeps it relevant for student for their lifetime? And that is a big challenge. I think that is the biggest challenge for all of us. We are all into the same profession and we do our job in a different manner. We want to make it our entire offering in such a manner that becomes interesting. But for me personally, and I hope that is true for all of us, is something that what is it that I teach and the way I teach that becomes relevant for that person for lifetime. And that is where I'll be emphasizing in this session. This is the context that I'm trying to give. So just to give you a recap, just imagine that the way things happened in the Industrial Revolution in late 19th century, and that gave way to a different kind of education system that we all have gone through. Suddenly now this is happening exactly today, and this is giving way to a different kind of education system. And that is where we need to pitch in, and we need to reflect that what is it that we are doing is something which is making this relevant and interesting to people. Is it exciting to students in the classroom? If we are not able to excite them, I think we have not done our job. And I always say to my colleagues and to everybody that if you are not exciting yourself, you cannot excite someone else. So we have to be exciting in the class. And how exciting and how can we reach that state of excitement is something that I'll tell you the framework that I have been using, and we can also take help from this. Another thing which is very important is one thing that we all focus is learning to learn has become one of the hallmarks of today's learning and teaching for the past decade. That how do you teach a student so that they learn how to learn? Because that is one thing that we need to emphasize. And I would add two more things as that. Comfort in the face of complexity and control over one's working memory. Today I want to talk about forgetfulness and memory and the way we create all those things. But when people talk about learning to learn, we must understand that it is a very complex world. And everybody, I'm not talking about for the past 6 months, but otherwise also, the complexity is so much that it is difficult for every individual to understand what is happening in the surrounding, what is happening in the classroom, what is happening in the campus, what is happening in my family, what is happening in political and other circle. It is so difficult to navigate for a student. So how can we provide comfort in the face of complexity? And the second point that I'm raising, how can you teach them to control over one's working memory so that they remember, that becomes relevant for them. So these are the two keywords that I would like you to remember going forward. Again, I say that remember, teaching theory and concept is very important. If they do not know what is theory, if they do not know what is the concept, if their teaching and if their learning is not about theoretical learning, most of the time they will fail to understand the explanation of what is happening outside. That is important. But too much reliant on theory and teaching theory as a theory is something that we need to rethink. And that is where another point that I want to make it. That I'm not saying that we do away with the kind of training that we are doing, we do away with the kind of things that we do, disciplinary teaching and all those things. We get into this, but at the same time, we need two things. The hard facts that they need to know, the theory that they need to know so that they can explain what is happening. They have the capacity to explain things, but at the same time, we need to teach them the skill set. That will make them relevant for the lifetime or the kind of market that they'll be entering. So keeping these things in mind, again, I recall these things, that always remember that we have to do something which makes the concept or the theory or the teaching that we do, that makes it relevant for them for the lifetime. I remember one of the quotes from the great author V.S. Naipaul. Somebody was taking interview of V.S. Naipaul, I think somewhere close to 2019 or 2009 or 10. And that fellow asked V.S. Naipaul that your books are so relevant now. even today when we read, though it has a bit of non-fiction and otherwise and some personal touch, but still today it is so relevant. I mean, what method did you apply to make your writing so relevant for generations to come? And V.S. Naipaul said that that question was very much in my mind when I was writing those fictions and non-fiction. And he said that when I would write something, I would keep it after writing 10 pages and I would leave it like that. And after 10 days, I would read again and see, okay, is it relevant after 10 days or not? And I would find it relevant or not, or the portion which are relevant, I would keep it. And the portions which were not relevant, I would not keep it. Then he would say, I would do this exercise with himself almost for a year or for a year or two. And he would say that I would constantly ask this question, that if I'm writing this chapter or I'm writing this piece of that particular novel or nonfiction, will it be relevant after 100 years, after 200 years? And that's how I kept myself updated. And I kept myself reminding that I need to make my writing relevant. And that is one exercise that he did. And I found that particular note by V.S. Naipaul very relevant even for my teaching and learning. I said that, okay, whatever we do in the classroom, if I start applying V.S. Naipaul's framework and just rethink and recollect in my memory that whatever I'm teaching today to my student, will it be relevant for tomorrow, day after tomorrow, 10 years, 50 years? And what part will be relevant? Because a context or a situation that I'm teaching him or her may be relevant today or not, but what is it that is that will be relevant in the memory of the student forever? And I reflect on this when I create a project or an assignment, and I try to highlight that in my session. So I do that job. And this is what I wanted to highlight here, that we should do something that makes sense and stays relevant. Other thing that I wanted to highlight is that a lot of people are talking about learning to learn, but we must understand that we need to provide comfort. At the same time, we need to work on their memory. That is where we can make our teaching and learning relevant. So keep these two things in mind. That is my understanding. And then I know that we all emphasize without a particular learning of a particular concept from a particular discipline, it will be very difficult for us to say that or to do something that we do in the classroom. So I am not discounting on that. I'm saying that let us combine these two things and create a blend of it, where we also talk about the hard facts. At the same time, we also talk about the skill set and we make sure that it happens. And we'll discuss, I'll tell you that in a syllabus, in a course outline, how can we make these two combination, the patchwork of hard fact and theory and the learning outcome relevant, and then put it in our syllabus. That I'll talk about it. Another thing that I'm very curious right from the beginning when I started teaching and getting into this profession is something that I was very curious, that why do I forget something? Like whatever was taught to me or whatever I came to know a year ago, I only remember 2-3 things or 4-5 things. I do not remember exactly what happened last year, what happened in that class in that year. So it means that there is something called forgetting. And that is a very much a part of our entire learning and teaching experience. And when we do this need-based analysis of a student, we discount this side. We never focus on this forgetting. The moment we start understanding and making it a part of our entire curriculum design and the classroom, the power of forgetting, I think that will change entirely the way we look at the education and we look at teaching and learning. Now, before we begin this, I would like to ask everybody, before we get on to this topic, how many of you have heard about a name called Borges, who was a writer from Uruguay? Have you ever heard about him? If you have heard, do you know any famous story about Borges? Jean-Louis Borges, and he was a very famous writer. They write it like B-O-R-G-E-S. Have you read anything from that writer, or have you come across this name? Because I'm sure that most of us would have read something or the other from him. He was a master storyteller. And he wrote a very good short story. So I would like to know if you have read Borges and if you know any work from him. I would love to know that. So may I request anybody to pitch in? And if you know, that is fine. If you do not know, then somebody can indicate me.
No, we don't know.
Okay. So this writer is a writer of fantasies. He has written about fantasies, and the moment he writes something, and if you read something from Borges, you feel like it is coming from some other planet. He wrote a very good short story, a very fascinating short story. The name of the short story is Affumes the Memorious. And the short story begins like this. The narrator of the story is Borges himself, and he goes to meet a friend or a person whose name is Fumes. And he goes there and he learns that he met with an accident when he was doing his horse riding. And because of that accident, there was some part of his brain got affected. And then after that, Fumes started remembering everything. So you can imagine the capacity of that person. Something happened to his brain. And as a result, he started remembering everything. So he would exactly remember the symmetry of the cloud. Like, for instance, if you ask Fume, what was the cloud symmetry and cloud formation yesterday or day before yesterday or in June, he would exactly tell you that, okay, when I looked, where the sky was looking like this, and when you look at this part of the sky, the cloud formation was something like this. He would also tell you exactly, if you look at it is in the story that I'm narrating you. He said that if you look at the glass of wine, so he would tell you the exact shape of the glass, what is inside the wine and everything. And that fellow got that kind of, a different kind of capacity, that he would remember every fine detail. And as a result, he started living in a dark room. Because when you remember everything, it becomes a kind of too much information for you. And it's very difficult for you to manage. So you do not know what to do with that information when you remember everything. So what he did, he kept himself in a very dark room where he could not see anything. Because if you see something, then you will remember. Otherwise, if you do not see something new, you can imagine, but you cannot remember. Then it will save you from remembering every minute detail. Like we are doing a Zoom session, like we are sitting here, like I ate early in the morning, like I went for a walk. They would remember. So this is what he did. And Borges went to him. And then he had a, if you look at this story, and I can see that one person has written that I have read the story, I think. So very good. So, you would recall this. What happens at the end of the story? That he died. And then you start guessing whether he died because he remembered everything or what happened to him. There was some problem. And I take that story as a kind of learning for me when I get into teaching and learning. That it is very important for us and for our student to forget things. If they do not forget, I think it will be impossible for all of us to do whatever we do in our life. And based on that, the need-based analysis that we'll be doing of our student, I want to make this entire concept as a base of our entire teaching and learning effort. The power of forgetting. And in the power of forgetting, two things that these are the two psychologists who gave this concept. And they said that we need to focus on, whenever we create a syllabus or we design a program or we do whatever, we need to focus on something which is called two things, retrieval of strength and storage of strength. And he said that how well do you learn? So how, this storage, how well do you store? And retrieval is how accessible it is when you want to remember it. So when we design our syllabus or when we teach something, we should blend the concept or that module's learning in such a manner that we should have two elements. One is what the facts that people remember, that they can learn, that they can talk about, and the things that they can remember. If we design a syllabus making these two things, whether we are teaching online and offline, I think that will change the entire dynamics of teaching and learning and the way we perceive it. It is very important for us as a teacher, and I hope you all agree with me, that we have to focus on this forgetting element. Once we focus on the forgetting element, we'll be able to focus on the learning element. But if we discount forgetting and we only focus on learning, we'll be kind of creating a violence on the mind and body of the learner. So I want to focus, I want you to understand and take this concept in mind. I've shared the reading. You can read it in detail. But something like that you need to take in account. Now here I would like to stop on the retrieval strength and storage strength. And I would like you to kind of tell me something from your experience, and I would like you to reflect whatever I've said. I mean, what do you think about it? What are your views? If you would like to add something in this case. So far, whatever we have done so far, whatever things that I have highlighted about the context, about the things that I want, I mean, that I practice on my own, and I request people to do that, and the power of forgetting. So far, any comment that you have or anything that you would like to add from your experience, that would be really nice to hear.
So I'd like to say something at this point. First of all, thanks a lot, Sudhir, for taking time out and doing this session for us. And I think what you said about forgetting, the power of forgetting, is so relevant for us as teachers, especially as the length of our career increases. You know, even this morning during the panel discussion, Professor Asha Kaul also spoke about unlearning and relearning as essential skills as we move forward into a hybrid learning model. And I think this anecdote from the story, as well as the entire concept of the power of forgetting that you're talking about, fits so well into that theory, because so many times the mistake that we tend to make is clinging too hard to what we have done in the past. I've met so many faculty members, and when we're talking about something, maybe introducing something in the classroom or doing an assessment in a new way, the first reaction is, but we've always done it this way. You know, that is, I think, of course, familiarity is comforting, and one likes to fall back on familiarity. But this is not the time to stay on it. It's time to forget the way things were being done in the past and move on to things which are more relevant, even if it means that it takes some effort in adapting those things. So I think this whole concept of the power of forgetting is very valuable for us teachers in these times.
So much, man. Thank you so much for joining us. Yeah. So, I mean, thank you so much for saying this. That's why, I mean, to make it, I mean, the biggest challenge, in fact, for me has always been, how do I make my classes or my syllabus or something relevant? And then I went back to this question that, okay, if I am talking about the relevant, do I consider the context in mind? And if I consider the context in mind, then I'm able to predict what will happen in the future, or at least I can imagine. And based on that imagination, I think I try to make that syllabus. And that's how we have also been working. I mean, I've worked with you for a long time. I know that's how your approach is. At the same time, we teach a lot of facts. We teach a lot of things. But do they remember that or not? And if they remember, how do they remember? And that's why it was very important. And again, I go back to the quote that it is not about the experiential learning, the experience that you gain, but it is about the reflection that you do. And another thing here I would also like to add, that always remember that experiential learning has nothing to do with the real life experience. That is the beginning of it. Experiential learning is all about teaching the leadership skills to people. So keep that in mind, because if there is no reflection in experiential learning, they will not learn anything. And that reflection as a teaching learning outcome will turn into how do they navigate in a very complex world. How do they manage themselves? How do they coordinate in the team? That is the part of experiential learning. So when you give them a project, when we give them a project, they have to do something. It is not the project that they learn, but in the process, they learn to coordinate. They learn to search material on their own. They learn to apply the theory. And the way they manage this entire project is something that they learn. Other things I think I have seen that people forget. So this is what I said, that in the what is it that I want in my syllabus? Student to retain, and what is it that I want them to forget? They can store and they can forget, but something that they retain, the experience that they retain, the kind of approaches that they learn during that time, they can forget about the concept and the theory, but the approaches that they learn, I think that makes it more effective learning. And that is the first need-based analysis that I wanted to get into. Now, after this, we all have seen this, and here I want to get quickly what is it that we have been doing for a very long time is this. In fact, today also most of the time we do. Like a single school student, like the way I'm saying that, okay, individual professors, these are the mechanism through which we can do. But first I'll go through the mechanism and then we'll get into the discussion. So I'm saying that we are moving, we have moved a lot, but still we need to remind ourselves that this is what that we need to do. From individual to team teaching. Now that is impossible, difficult in our context, but we should get into. Like inviting some expert from the industry or inviting someone else who gives a different kind of perspective in our course is something very important. So if 2 persons cannot teach a course together, which is impossible given our workload, given the constraint in which we operate, at least keeping at least 2 to 3 lectures from outside people, whether it is industry or some of your colleagues in the institution or someone else, makes a lot of difference. So from individual to team teaching, if we get into this, I think we address the need of the student in a different way. From lectures and assignment to exercises and project, because the moment you do the exercise in the classroom, there is a quick feedback that happens. And I have seen invariably that students really admire that kind of approach. We are too much into analytics and we ask them to analyze. We say that you need to hone your analytical skills and all. But I'm saying that, okay, can we talk about something which is happening on day-to-day basis? Can we bring something from the real life, which is very familiar to them, which is emerging as a problem, which is emerging, and rather than getting into something which is already fixed, probably that gives them a sense of a feeling that they have learned something about the real world and about the concept. Thinking, and I'm saying that, okay, we do we discuss in the classroom, there is a debate, we invite a student to provide their view, that is fine, but let them do something and then get into the discussion. When you give them something to do and get into discussion, they feel very close to you. They feel very close to the subject. I think that is something very important. It takes a lot of time, a lot of effort at our level. Most of us do it. But I'm just saying that it is very important for us to kind of keep on emphasizing on this and remind ourselves that I need to do this rather than giving them the assignment and giving them some tasks to do. Give them something to do and let us discuss. In fact, to tell you very honestly, it looks really stupid in the classroom to ask a student that, can you say something about it? Because most of the time in our context, they have nothing to say, or they're not very vocal, they're not very articulate. But let us talk, okay, what did you do? What is your experience? Okay, you did this project, let us begin. It is very much possible that they will not say anything, but they will open up. In fact, in some of the sessions, it feels like a futile effort that I have not taught anything. I just spoke to the kids and I just spent my entire 90 minutes or 75 minutes interacting with the student, and it looks really boring at the end of the day. And as a teacher, we do not get that sense of achievement that I have taught something. But I think sometimes out of 30 lectures or 20 lectures that we do, keep 5 lectures where you actually interact with the student. I have followed that approach and it is really good, because the moment you get into this kind of talking to a student, you get to learn more about their approach of learning about the subject. So keep 2-3 lectures of 30, 40 lectures that we teach, or 20 lectures, where we only get into discussion. Discussion means talk to them, because I've seen that when you talk to a student, they feel very close to you. They feel very close to the subject. And that is where you can bring in the comfort. The comfort that I was saying, that in this complexity, we need to bring in the comfort. At the same time, give them something where they fail. It is very important. And in one of the projects I'm doing that, where it is not making sense to them, even if they do, it is not giving them a sense of achievement. I think the moment they get into this, then they try to learn something and they are kind of disappointed in the process. They do not agree. They are sad. And then you bring in your perspective and you try to help them. I think that gives them a sense of, again, a sense of community. They feel that, okay, they were doing something and they lost in the way, and then you are helping. These are the ways in which you can bring the student closer to your subject and to yourself as well. And from rigorous analysis, let us get into testing, the way you evaluate, the way you create the parameters on which you'll be evaluating. Get into this, do this process again and again. I know that it is very difficult, but at least in one assignment or in one concept, if we can do this twice, I think that will help us to do whatever we wish to do in terms of their need testing. And then rather than subject, somebody knows the concept, that is fine. But knowing the concept is good, but at the same time, he should know how to apply that concept and make sense in the real world. So if you know some concept in mathematics or accounting, or for instance, in marketing, knowing that concept is very good. You know, you are the expert, you have learned that concept, but how can you bring that concept into a process where it really makes sense? Otherwise, the one complaint that we hear from all industry people all over the world is that they say that the kind of education that kids receive at your institution, when they join our institution, they know nothing. And we have to teach everything right from the beginning. Because these people in industry or otherwise, wherever they get into their job, our kids, there the focus is all about the process and the result at the end. Here, the focus is not more about process, but the focus is about the concept and the subject that we do. If we get into this kind of framework, then probably, and if we apply this consciously, I mean, knowing this and talking about this is another thing, but getting into this and applying this in the real life, the way we do things, is entirely different thing. So just keep on reminding ourselves and get into this kind of framework. I think I also partly come, now I'm fully in management. And I tell you, one thing I appreciate about management education is, it has framework for everything. And in real life, we need framework. Like as a teacher, as an instructor, I need a framework to work on. And management education does this to you. It provides you a framework which you can implement. And I think this is one framework that will be really helpful for us to understand their need, whether we are doing online and offline. Then another thing that I want to focus is this one. The entire journey of teaching and learning begins from knowing. And knowing means first we begin as teaching, then learning. And then the third one, the C one that you see, learning how to learn, which is the focus of the entire world. Every top institute is talking about this. And next one is less analytical and more application. Less what and more so what. So this is the first stage that we should get into. So when we are designing a syllabus or a program, first process is this, that get into knowing. And this knowing can be done in different ways. And these are the ways through which we can climb. Second one is doing. So from once they know the subject or we teach the subject, people know the subject, then we get into the next part, which is applicable to both of us, which gets into practice, experience, experiential learning, creating a project or making that relevant in the real world, like getting into industry for both of us, for faculty and for a student both. And then last one is being. So when I present this pyramid to you, actually, in a way, I'm talking about the purpose of education. This is, at the end, the purpose of education: knowing, doing, and being. And the moment we get into being, it is all about self-awareness, ethics, our role in society, and all those things, whatever that could get into my head, I put it here. So what is happening all over the world, like climate change, urbanization, whatever is happening, how do I kind of perceive these things, and how do I make myself relevant for this? So we progress in our life, and that is also the purpose of education, from knowing to doing to being. Clear? Now, this is the sad fact of the entire thing. All of us, whatever we do, and I'm sorry to say this, and if I'm wrong, please correct me, but in our day-to-day exercise, whether we are designing a program or a syllabus or whatever we do, mostly we are here. We are into teaching, learning, and learning how to learn. Once we get into here, most of us are here. Even if as an individual instructor, we are not here, at least the program structure makes sure that we get into the industry immersion and experiential learning. And at the end of the day, university makes sure that they become this kind of citizen. But the sad part is we are here. And we have to move from this part to the next part to the next part. We have to move to these three parts at all level, at the individual level when we design a syllabus, at the same time at the broader level when we design the program, at the same time at the final level when they graduate. So even in our syllabus, we need to have this framework in mind. And I think if we keep this, that will make us more relevant, because the moment you get closer to each of the pyramid, each of the stages, I think you have to do that need-based understanding of the student. This is what I wanted to say apart from that, one more topic, I want to have a kind of discussion in the last moment. One more topic that I wanted to do, keeping all these frameworks in mind, what I did for my purpose is that recently I ran this happiness survey because we are doing this Zoom session and we are getting into entire semester, past semester, half of the past semester and this semester. This has gone into this online teaching and learning. So what I did, and we are talking about hybrid things. So I ran this survey and I called it the happiness survey for a student. For my purpose, I wanted to know whether they are happy or not. And I want to share that framework with all of us. And I'll tell you what is the result that I got, and then we can discuss on this. So what I did, I created a very simple thing with the help of my program manager. I said, let us float this questionnaire to our students. And if you can see, these are the questions that I did. This is a very simple for the student. And I put questions like, I find online classes more convenient, flexible. I can get the recording of my sessions. And I said, put it like this kind of scaling. In online education, study materials are available online for teaching and learning. In online classes, students sometimes neglect courses because of the personal and professional circumstances. And these kinds of 14, 15 questions, and wherever I have put it red, in second round, I removed it. And I put questions like this. I'm able to manage my study time effectively. As a student, I enjoy working independently. As a student, I enjoy working with other student groups. I feel that the experience of being on campus studies is much more healthier for a student. So this kind of survey I ran. And to tell you very honestly, the kind of feedback that I got is that something that a student said, that resource is something very important for them. They want to access to that resource. It is not really possible for them to remember everything in the classroom. And before that, we did not realize. So to tell you very honestly, I never recorded my class. Recording happened sometimes, but not always. And that kept a student waiting to understand the concept for a longer period of time. And most of the time, they did not learn. In this one, the result that I got is, they said that they really are benefiting from the recorded sessions that they have. It means that if you make the resource available to a student for free, whether regarding a syllabus, about a module, about a project that you do, if you record the experience and make it available, whether it is good, bad, whatever, but if you create that resource and make it available, it really benefits a student in a different way. And they are really happy that in the online mode, they can go and retrieve the material and the recording, and they can get back and they can study. Now, again, I'm saying with a bit of caution, it is not applicable to everyone. There are students all over the world, in fact, everywhere, that they do not attend classes. They say that we have this connection problem and all, and they disappear. Then they go back to recording. So it has its own disadvantages. But at the same time, the need is that the one need that I identified from this small exercise is that student want the kind of resource which they really appreciate. And that resource is what is happening in the classroom. So I can make my material available. We all prepare our course mat and give it to them. We all have our PDFs and circulate it to them. But whether they read that or not, there is no guarantee. If you create that one assignment and keep that reading as a part of that assignment, probably they remember it or not. But what they want to remember and what they want to access is the classroom experience. So they are going back to the reading and that classroom recording, and they are learning from it, they are listening to it. And those who want to really benefit from it, they benefit from it. So one thing that I've learned, that my real resource from the student need, real resource is not the course mat, real resource is not the PPT that I share, real resource is not the reading that I share, that is always there. But the real resource is the classroom engagement. What is happening in the classroom? When somebody asked a question, how did I reply? What did I say? How did I explain a particular concept to the student? I think that is the real resource. So from this survey, the one thing that I got, that no matter whether I'm doing today or tomorrow, whether today online and tomorrow offline, I would love to record my each and every session and make it available to the student, because the real experience is the classroom experience. That is the most valuable resource for them. At the same time, they miss working in a team. So what I did, I started creating my project or assignment which involves team, because they may not realize and they may not appreciate otherwise, but students want to work in team. They want to, this is what they said, that this online mode and not making it possible, I'm not meeting their friends in the physical environment, is making their entire experience burdensome. So if you remember, I raised this concern that our job is not only to make them learn how to learn, but our job is also to provide them comfort, because it is a very complex environment. Even today, tomorrow, even before Corona, the environment is really complex for a student. And they find comfort only in the lap of their own friends. So can we design? So what I did, I started designing every assignment, which involves at least 4 to 5 students or 2 to 3 students working together. Now, that is one change that I did. Based on the need analysis, I kept it as a happiness survey. But that was actually what ma'am asked me to do, this need-based analysis. I realized that, okay, what ma'am is asking me to talk about, exactly this is what I did. Clear? And that made their entire learning experience far better than anything. And I would like to use these two things, creating more teamwork, like creating a pair assignment, creating a group assignment more, and making it comfortable for our students so that others can also collaborate and they can do. And creating a resource of not of my reading list that I borrow from Harvard, I borrow from some other writer and theorist and put it in my syllabus and make it look like a very erudite syllabus, but creating the resource of my lecture, which I do in the classroom, creating it, storing it, and making it available to a student is something which is very important that I have learned from this online and offline teaching. So these are the 2-3 elements that I wanted to highlight. These are the things that came up. And one thing, again, I realized that we think that, okay, we have given some assignment to a student or we are teaching a concept to a student, they'll be doing something else. But when I got into the qualitative feedback, when I invited a student and I started talking to them that, okay, I'm going to circulate this survey, you need to participate. What do you think? I mean, I put it these questions in front of them and they said and asked them that, look at these questions, what do you think? What do you do? So we must realize that they do a lot of other things in their free time. It is not something that 24/7 they are getting into our own, whatever we teach, we feel really important about it and we feel that, okay, they should be doing that. No, they do a lot of other things. In fact, they roam around, they play, and this is what we discount. We forget about this when we are into a class. So when I started asking, one thing that came up and that was, from almost everybody is that, sir, we get a lot of time. So I said, what do you do in that time? Everybody said that everybody quoted not some academic activity, but some activity that they're passionate about. So remember, then that got into my head that, okay, they're not going out. Nobody's allowing them to go out. They're doing everything at home. It is all work from home for them as well. But even it is not important for them to go out and do that activity, but they can pursue their passion even by being at home, and they do something different rather than getting into their assignment and project. So it is not something that they're learning 24/7. They're doing something else as well. And they can do it very well at their houses, at their abode, at their, at their residence as well. And this is something that we must appreciate. I think that is one comfort that we can provide to these people. So these are the things that came in my mind based on my experience, and I started changing my entire project and assignment, and I think even going forward I'll include that. And the framework that now I remind myself, though I do individual teaching, but I remind myself that I need to move away from this to this. I need to do something from this to this. And sometimes working with the assignment with them also helps them a lot. So these are the things that we need to do, and if we can do that, will be really nice. That is all I wanted to say from my end. I'll share the framework and the PPT. I will share it with ma'am and then it can be circulated. So I can take comments or questions or anything that is there.
Thank you, Dr. Sudhir Pandey. It was wonderful listening to you. You are right. We will be sharing all the PPTs, the reading material with all the participants. It is going to be a part of the third session that we have for the day. We have kept a slot for deliberation and discussion. So these will be shared with the participants. We'll be getting back with them and then we'll be talking about this more. Now, we have a few questions that have come to us while the session was going on. I'm going to pose one or two because we need to move on to the next session also.
Yeah.
But one of the questions that we have received, the first one that if you could answer, is Dr. Mamta has posed this question. How to manage the conflicting needs of various educational stakeholders? So basically, needs analysis of which stakeholder is more important. The student, the administrative responsibilities, or the policymakers, where do we strike a balance going ahead?
Yeah, I mean, this is a very difficult question for me because I have been managing this program for the last 2 years, basically last 2 to 3 years. And we need to keep, I mean, we have, I'm not going to give a very ideal answer that, okay, we need to only focus on the students, because the teaching learning process involves everybody. In fact, involves the administration, which is the most important part. I mean, those who are in administration, they know that we are working 24/7. And there is no discount from that. And what we do here is actually to benefit the students. So saying that, okay, we discount on our administrative responsibility, as a faculty of 3-4 years back, I can very well say that, oh, I am into a lot of, today I will not say, because I am into that process and I've been designing, redesigning, managing, and whatever we do at the administrative level, that is the one of the most important stakeholders. Please do not discount on that. And I'm not being political because ma'am is here, but I'm being very honest that the administration of any university or any institute, whatever they do, they're actually facilitating you and the, I mean, teacher and the student. So in fact, that is a lot about learning. In fact, entire administrative role is all about facilitating learning, nothing else. It is not about managing. See, control cannot make sure that the learning will happen. So it is not about controlling. It is not about managing. Actually, administrative role is also about facilitating. Clear? At the same time, if you look at the teacher, I mean, as an individual instructor, again, our job is focus on our syllabus and focus on the way you create your assignment, create your learning outcome. Because the moment you focus more on that, you are actually benefiting the student. Clear? So I will say that need-based analysis, I mean, forgive me, but I'll put the administration one at the top. I'm not saying they're at the top, but I'm saying that just keep it in the hindsight. And remember that entire process is actually going to help the student. So you, even if you're not the program chair or director, or you're not the part of the program manager team, or you're not the part of that administration, you must know as an individual what is happening there. And what is it that they're doing day in and day out? Because that will help you to design your syllabus and to understand the kind of approach that the university is following. So keep that in mind. Whenever you design something, keep that in mind. At the same time, the context that I said, appreciate what is happening. And appreciate that whatever I do at the syllabus, at the module level, whatever I teach, the kind of concept, how relevant it is and how relevant will it be even after 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years. Keep that in mind. So the biggest stakeholder after your university and administration is the context in which this teaching and learning is happening. Once you do that, then you are getting into, because if your objective of your university is to create problem solver, then your course should better create a structure at the course level, which is whether you are teaching communication or teaching literature or teaching law or teaching marketing or teaching accounting, your guiding principle has to be creating a problem solver as a kind of learning outcome. Keep that in mind. So keep your university's philosophy, vision, and mission. If my university's philosophy, vision, and mission is to create decision makers, then at the individual level, my syllabus should do that. So that's why I'm saying that stakeholder is very important, because we have to follow that mission and vision. And accordingly, I have to create my syllabus. Then come to the context in which I am creating, in which my university exists, in which my syllabus exists. Keep that in process, because that is the context of your teaching and learning. Then come to the kind of people that you want to keep it in your syllabus, like the theorist, the example from the industry. What kind of theory would you like to take? There are a lot of theories. There are a lot of explanation of those theories. Whom do you think that is another next important stakeholder, that who will be the part of your syllabus? Who are the theorists? Who are the authors? Who are the writers? Who are the, examples that you want to bring in your syllabus? So that is the third one. And then keep yourself, and then keep your students. So do not see that as a hierarchy, that I'm saying that keep a student at the end. If you keep these things in this order, then mostly 50%, you have taken the need of the student in mind. Clear? You are benefiting them in a different way. And then student, when you come to a student, then forget about this, because this you have taken care of at the level of your syllabus, at the level of your execution, at the level of your preparation. Now, when you come at the end to the student, then I would request you to be more face-to-face, to bridge the gap and to have a kind of discussion, talk to them. When I say that keeping student preference in mind and being close to them, I'm being very generous. It is very difficult. I mean, the kind of student that we get, to tell you very honestly, and the kind of tricks that they do, most of the time it is disappointing. But that's fine. That is the part of the job. Clear? When I record my lecture and put it, I know that there are students who have just logged in and they have disappeared. Or if I make that classroom experience as a part of the resource and put it, I know that they may not focus in the classroom and they disappear, but that is fine. Just relax on that part, because we have to deal with that. And who knows, out of 100, 10 or 20 or 5 may benefit from this, but do that. And that's why, if you remember, I have shared one framework as a part of reading, where we are talking about the MIT, that framework, where we are talking about the capacity of the student and the way we design a syllabus. So I would request everybody to go through that reading. So when we come to a student, most of the time it is disappointing. Some of the times it is the kind of student that we deal with. But it is good. I mean, creating a store of, resource of the classroom, something that we can do. And for your benefit, you can just discount. So these stakeholders are very important. And they are not in the order of hierarchy, but I request you to keep them in mind when you get into the need-based analysis. That was my response.
Thank you, Dr. Sudhir Pandey. That was a very good answer, because generally students, faculty members and the administration, they are pitched against each other in a constant battle of whose needs are important. But the way that you have presented it, it is very organic, that each one leads to the rest and it flows down organically. So I think that has answered the question very well. I know we are towards the end of the session, but I'll take one more question, brief question. Everybody is really looking forward to the happiness questionnaire that you have created. And
okay. So I'll share that. I'll share with ma'am and then it can be.
Yes, sir. Yeah. So everybody is asking this. You've shared the responses with us, but how did the students take it? What was their initial reaction when a faculty asks them or a chair asks them whether they are happy with the kind of online teaching that is happening or not? What was the initial reaction of the students? That's something that they
all... I knew that if I circulate something like this suddenly, that would surprise them. So what I did, I held two meetings separately before circulating this. And in one meeting, I only talked about what is happening. Okay, what is happening otherwise? See, even our country, everything is, it looks like we are mismanaging. Look at this. So I started sharing my personal experience. Okay, for the past, June 9th, I came to Lucknow and I'm still in Lucknow. I have to get back to Ahmedabad and all. And then I started talking to them and I spoke to them. And then I said that we are really worried and we know that everything is tough for you. And we know. So the moment you talk to a student, the kind of student, ma'am, that we deal with, they start complaining about everything, about the system, about me, about the teachers and everything. I jot down those things. And then I said that, okay, let me address. I met in the second meeting and I started addressing that, okay, you said this, I have been able to do this, you said this. And even if I was not able to solve that, I started providing a rationale that, okay, whatever you are saying, see, here is the possible solution. Okay, whatever you are saying, this is what we have done. And then after the end of second session, then I said, okay, now these things are done. Now I want your opinion. I want to understand and I want to design the entire thing, because we are going to be online forever. And even if we are not going to be online, this online is going to become one of the most important part of our curriculum and teaching and learning. And I want to include the best part of this online to our offline. So I'm circulating this questionnaire and I ran this questionnaire to them. And then I circulated. Otherwise, the bias view is the moment you do something like this, because students are always unhappy, most of them, they respond in a very different manner. So these two processes that I went through, first one, just getting their responses. It was very, not a very pleasant response in the first session. Second one, I talked about them. Then I talked about this questionnaire. And then I circulated this. And then I got. And this I have started doing, in fact, with my every subject. In fact, I teach a course, Effective Workplace, where I actually talk about the history of office. So when I say workplace communication, I focus on workplace, not on soft skills and all. And then I got a response from one student. He said that this can be done with this, a history of office and the structure of office can be easily taken from the Google. We don't need instructor for this. So you also get this kind of response. And then I started doing this happiness survey from my each courses because I'm in the middle of, you're all in the middle of the semester. And that benefited me in a different way. So talking to them and then circulating. Otherwise, they will give you a different kind of response. So that was the process that I followed.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much for sparing time on a Sunday and talking to our participants on such an important topic of needs analysis and student perception about online teaching and learning. On behalf of GLS University's Faculty of Business Administration, formerly known as NRBB, I thank you for taking this particular session. Thank you so much.
As far as the participants are concerned,
we'll be starting with our next session at 12:30. We have Professor Uday Damodaran from IIM Udaipur, who will be talking to us about do curriculum and syllabus design need a change. We request the participants that the meeting will be kept on. You are free to be logged in the session, or you may log out and then join us also. But the next session will start at 12:30 sharp. I request you to join in. If you are logging out, please log in at least 10 minutes before the session starts. Thank you so much. We'll see you at 12:30.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, ma'am, for inviting.